Hang on. Jeez, Twitch, giving me such a hard time. I still don't know if I'm streaming when I start streaming. Okay, now I see the chat. Can someone give me a hey, you're streaming, or something like that if I'm streaming? Are we streaming? Are we in? Yeah. Right? I think I see you guys. Do you guys see me? Okay. Thanks, guys. What are you doing behind me? What are you doing?
I just want to, like, you turn over here, like, yo, I'm ending this.
All right.
And we're going to just go to Twitch.
All right. That's fine. Don't worry. That's fine. What's up, guys? How we doing? Everybody doing okay? Purge, people are asking about you. You can say hi to people.
What's going on?
Got my boy Purge here. Got my dog.
We in the building.
We back in studio. So last night we did a... You're going to be weirding me out.
I'm done, don't you?
Yesterday we did a... nice, I see you guys. Yesterday we did a stream from the house where we were drinking hot sauce and trying different hot sauces and asking your guys questions. That was a little all over the place. That was a lot of fun. That's what I was looking for. I was trying to keep that sort of rapid fire. However, today, last night was a lot of fun. You can see highlights of last night on my Twitch channel. So all you got to do is go on the Twitch channel. I'm learning as we go, but I think I now have highlights like us talking about different things, us going through unreleased funky tunes and stuff like that on there. So you can see clips of that. You can also watch, you guys video chatted with Brian and last year and all. You can see all that. You can also watch the entire thing. I think that stays up for a couple weeks before it disappears. I don't know. Learning as we go. But today, I'd like to keep this this whole chat based more off of production questions, like music production, right? So what I was thinking was this. We can do... Look, I'm open to suggestions. I'm still learning, so I'm not sure what the best format is for this. I'm thinking maybe you guys asking questions. Yeah, I could make a couple leads today. I'm thinking you guys like asking questions on here, and obviously the chat moves quickly, so you can re-ask, you can repeat your questions. I don't know if somebody has a better solution, please let me know, and I'll just try to answer things as we go. I do want to do demo submissions. I would like to lean more towards just general production questions on this stream. I'm also down to work on the song that we started from scratch, but I would also similarly like to do that in its own session. So I think it would be cool to have more sort of sessions, one that is based more off a production Q&A, one that's better demo submissions, one that's working on songs, so on and so forth. So, okay, can we make some leads? What's up, everybody? Where's up, William Blackton? And no laws when you're drinking claws, and no laws when you're mixing saws, right? All right. So let's start asking and answering some questions. Starting now, first couple ones. Which one's mine? Okay, I'll leave mine. All right. So whatever you guys drop in here, I will try to address to the best of my ability. What up, Sam? What up, man? You know. Understanding how and why you go up to like 200 tracks. Okay. So good question. So a lot of times, when I'm making a song, throwing paint at the wall in the creative phase, a lot of times that means trying a lot of different things, right? And if you try a lot of different things, you're going to take up a lot of space doing that. And then eventually I'll start to whittle it down. But so, for example, what you're seeing here, I have a project open right now, and this is the second project for the song. This is the project for my Alive remix that I did for Davin. And I can do some bass. Typically for each song these days, I have two project files at least. There's one main one where I start throwing a lot of paint at the wall, and a lot of times that project will get up to 200 some, maybe three, but usually around 200 some. And I'll float back through the comments to try to find the questions that I missed. Usually the songs will end up being, in that first project, a couple hundred tracks. That's me throwing a lot of paint at the wall. That's me auditioning snare drums. So I may have six or seven snare tracks that I'm floating between, trying to figure out which ones I like and which ones I don't. You know, it's trying out, okay, maybe this sub-bass sound works. Okay, maybe this one with a little more presence up top might work. Let's mute the old guy. Let's keep the new guy, see how we feel. Then when that project has gotten nice and beefy, nice and fat, and we're like, hey, that's too much, then I start a new project file, and then I bounce everything to, say, 25 stems or so. Kick, snare, sub, mid-bass, lead, saws, effects, chords, plucks, arps, right? Vocal stuff, ambiences. boom, new project file and work from there. And that's why, like, so this Alive remix, it ends up being about, you know, 100 and some tracks because it's gotten whittled down from that. And then ultimately, invariably, when I start the new song, I end up making a whole bunch more. Like, you'll see, like leads here is all the leads from the previous tracks, like when I made it in the one project file, right? Can you hear that? That's coming out the wrong speakers, isn't it? Hang on.
That's a pretty loud computer speaker.
Can you guys let me know if you hear that? Okay, all right. Tell me real quick. Can you guys hear that? Is the volume okay? Is the song, do you hear it? You hear it? Is the volume okay? Louder or quieter on the, all right, good. Okay, so that's it. Let's go back. Bass growl sound design. Yeah, honestly, I haven't designed a bass wub since I got this new computer. I'm not your guy if it comes to like when it comes to like bass wubs and stuff like that. I've done a lot of sort of watching other people's streams, like Company and like Wooly and stuff like that, and trying to learn from them and figuring out how to do sounds that sort of like sound really cool. And then I bounce them to audio so I can reuse them. Like, for example, and I think that's some of the best advice I can give is, like, I spent, like, a couple weeks just watching a bunch of Company streams, right, and trying to learn how to make bass wubs like that. And then I bounced them all out. What was it called? Bass wubs? I don't know where they are. Bass wubs, right? And I'll bounce them up. I'll bounce them out to audio and I'll just make like all sorts of weird. Why do all these sounds? You know? Right? And then you bounce them out to audio and then you can reuse them. You can pitch them into your tracks and stuff like that. Just use Serum, watch other guys like dubstep guys' streams. And try to work that stuff in. That's the best advice I have on bass wubs right now. I'll go over it some other time if you want, but I'm not the best for, like, bass wubs. Mixing bass and super saws to sound cohesive and, like, one sound. That's the struggle, right? So, right. So that always becomes the biggest thing that you end up working on for a long period of time. So, like, a lot of times I'll get these ideas down, and then I'll continue spending weeks trying to sort of mold it. So this will have like, maybe the drop is a better idea, huh? Although the bass is not super present, but let's isolate that. Let's where are leads going somewhere else? So it might help to just hear them. Where are my basses? What was I doing here? What did I do? Here we go. Maybe they're all in here. Sorry, this is the condensed project, so it's with the saws. Honestly, like bass wubs, I'll tell you this. If you have like your mid bass or something and you have your saws sitting on top, honestly, a lot of times I'll EQ out most of the tops of the bass wub. Like I'll EQ out like, you know, if it's just the bass wubs, I'll put a little EQ and do one of these numbers. I'll try to open up another project and do one of those, you know, something like that to just sort of get the tops out and let the saws take the top of it. And, you know, and then you just hack away, you know, then you hack away a little bit at a time. How to fill out the production. Little effects and things like that, right? So maybe, again, it can help to hear some of these things separated. So, leads. So if I took out the saws and the mid basses, you get not nearly as. I think the idea is to know what your main sounds are, right? You have like your bass and your saw, your lead rather, and then your kick and your snare. And then that lead could be a vocal. And then you put other things around it. That's a big thing. It's like, let me see. Like for example, the vocal here, when that vocal comes in on the drop, I don't know if you guys get stereo information there, but those vocals spread straight out to the side to make room for the leads. Sorry. Much more centered. So I think it's about sort of finding, making sure, like, if you listen to these pop records, nothing bumps into each other. There's a healthy bit of overlap, but not too much, you know? All right, what else? No laws when you're mixing saws. I'm glad you like the remix. How do you generally like to start a song, guitar, random chords, a beat? Rarely is it a beat. Usually it will be, like, honestly, the best ones are usually when there's a vision, right? So, like Shatterpoint, for example, was I was trying to come up with like some sort of dark idea that might make you think you were gonna get like a trap song or something, and then it ends up exploding into these big chords, right? So like a vision, right? So then I think that was probably a guitar and trying to write out the chords. But almost always, like I was saying this on stream last night, I think my favorite ideas usually start out being written on a guitar. And sometimes, honestly, sometimes it comes down to like listening to songs that you like, especially songs of totally different genres, and being like, yo, like, guitar, you like this?
Can't reach.
So like The Surface, I don't know if any of y'all know the song The Surface, it's an old one, but like I was watching the freaking Lion King. And I heard the way the chords modulated, and I was like, ooh, could I, like, totally reinterpret that? Could I take sort of the relative idea the chords are doing, but put it in a totally different key and do it completely, completely sort of revamp the idea? Because, you know, you can't really just copyright a chord progression, I guess, like that. But, like, Lion King has a, what is that? You know what I'm talking about? Remember. See, what does it do? What is the line? Right? What's that? Interstellar, right? Yeah. But then I took that sort of and that turned into The Surface, whatever The Surface was. I don't remember. Something like that. Anyway, the idea basically, without you having to sit around, watch me dick around, trying to figure out what the chords are, you can take ideas from completely different things and try to figure out what makes them tick and reinterpret them in a way that becomes yours. And I think that's a really cool way to write music. When you start to get to the mixing stage, how do you typically compress your stuff? I'm getting around to learning how it works, but it's still eluding me. That's the challenge, right? Some guys use like OTT and all this crazy compression. I don't know if any of y'all saw that video of the Skrillex project file deconstructed, but he was doing he throws like maximizers on, it looked like every bus, right? Like his vocals and his, they all have their own little maximizer and everything, and that really I think helped make things sound real loud. I'll try to do stuff like that, but I try to keep things really dynamic, so almost everything gets compressed in some way. Some things more so than others, but I try to make sure nothing gets fatiguing. That's a big one. Like this song was real. I ended up, when I did the mastering on this song, it ended up being really on a live, really tough to make sure it hit hard, but didn't stay fatiguing, because you would come up here. Why not? Ah. Ooh, we turned off ours. Right, and that keeps going, and it keeps going, all high energy. So it's tough sometimes with compression. You don't want to just brick wall everything for too long, because after that whole drop into that big high energy vocal section, that'll start to feel fatiguing. So compression is, you know, it's one of those things you got to sort of fiddle around with a little bit. I don't know if I'm being helpful with some of these responses. Let me know if you guys want me to get more technical with some of this stuff. More tracks equals looks cooler. I'm glad you're dropping the set. What are some tips for writing instrumental / vocal-less tracks? What do you think?
I'm looking through the messages trying to see if you miss anything and trying to answer. What was that one?
Help me out with what you're talking about. That's cool.
Yeah, for sure. Someone said you can make me a mod, but I was like, okay, we'll work on that later.
Cool, we can do it. If you pass the tests.
Did you ever get those cigarettes?
What are some What are some tips? Shit. Hang on. What are some tips for writing instrumental / vocalist tracks? It's a good question. Try to have a focal point in any part. I think that's a big one. Try to make sure that you have a section. Like, there's always like something that the ear knows to focus on, right? Like that the listener knows that's what the ear should be going to. Is your pre-master just a group name or a routing preference? Yeah, it's a, it's both. It's a group name / a routing preference. So the reason for the pre-master channel, everything is going into it on this track. And different tracks I'll do differently. But for this one, I did the pre-master thing. The reason for that is because sometimes I'll drop reference tracks like up top and use like, you know, old tracks I've done, tracks by other artists, songs that sort of fill out the frequencies in a way that I think would be good for this song. And I'll use them to listen and A-B back and forth between my track and other tracks, sometimes between a bunch of tracks, right, to get a sort of feel for it if it sounds weird. But if you have effects on your master, even just like little things, like I try not to do too much on my master at all when I'm working, but like if you have like little EQ adjustments on your master or volume dips or something, you don't want that to impact the tracks, the reference tracks you're listening to. So I'll send them straight out to the master and send everything else in as pre-master bus and just put whatever sort of master things. I don't know. What do we do? Okay. Here I would have done, maybe before a drop. Yeah. So before a drop, I took a utility. And I automated the mid-side. Can you guys see that? There you go.
Are you recording the stream?
Yes. I automated the mid-side amount, so it would be... You know what I'm saying? You go in, you keep everything nice and steady, and for the drop. Right, so that's a good reason. And if I'm referencing another track, and I have the build linked up top right around here... then I don't want that track to get centered too. So that's the reason for using the pre-master bus. Okay. How long does it take to make a track like Shatterpoint? Shatterpoint took forever. Shatterpoint took like months and months and months of like tweaking and like, and just, I wonder if I have any old, I don't know, I'll have to see. I have to see if I can find old versions of that song. But like, yeah, it took a long time of just like tweaking. It was months. It must have been five months. I mean, some of the songs on this, on the upcoming EP, the title track, I started in like three or four years ago. Yeah. So these songs take a while. Some of them come together quickly. Your boy Jason Ross hit me up to remix Known You Before, and I had that thing done within a month, and that's really rare, but nowadays we're getting a little better at that.
How do you feel about going over different parts of the build-up? I feel like build-ups are one of my biggest struggles.
Cool, absolutely, yeah. Is that, am I going to skip a bunch before?
Yeah, maybe, that was
okay, amazing. Let's get there, though, that's good. Sounds like you're recording straight from computer. Sound is okay? Okay, sounds dope. Is there a general rule you have for leveling different parts of the song? Like, obviously, the drop should be the loudest part of the song, but the intros and verse, I never know how loud these sections should be, especially if there are drums in these sections. Yeah, that's tough. You got to think about a lot of things. Fatiguing is one thing. Look, like, if you're thinking about this, if you're thinking about how loud your non-drop sections should be, as opposed to thinking, how loud can I make all this stuff, you're already a little bit ahead of a lot of other guys, I think. Like, I mean, if you drop a bunch of dubstep tunes in a record box, everything is, like, almost always just brick wall the entire tune, right? So if you're thinking that sort of nuanced way, as sad as it is, you're ahead of the curve already, I think. I like to mix with the drop being the loudest part of the song, and then I will sort of mix, what's the word I'm looking for, I don't know, sort of circumstantially, if that's a word. So, for example, for the Known You Before remix, which you guys will hear, I knew that I wanted the song, the first verse, to be able to mix out of a buildup from another tune. In other words, I have it at 150 BPM. I want to be able to go from a dubstep tune into the first verse, into a hard cut, and go, boom, I feel I known you before. Then my track comes in. So I knew that I needed to make that opening section loud. I knew that I needed that first verse to be sort of as loud as, almost as loud as a drop. Other times it's a little more lenient, but for sometimes a good sort of tool for that is to sort of float around between your songs, between different parts. and be like, okay, does everything sound sort of balanced? And you learn how to sort of trust your intuition with that. Like, okay, does something feel a little quiet? Does something feel a little bit loud? One thing I've been doing lately is making my vocals louder. I think on some of my older tunes, I had my vocals, which one? I had my vocals a little bit quieter. So that's a big one. But yeah, what I've been trying to do lately is when I get the tune pretty much done, the one thing, sometimes I'll master my own tunes, but sometimes I'll send out for mastering, but I don't know, I'll go and listen to the master compared to other tunes, and they'll be like, all right, maybe this vocal just feels quiet, I should pull that up a little bit, you know, little things like that. I don't know, we can talk more about that.
What's up? Talk about your signature lead that someone...
People are asking about the lead, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, I'm like, I'm skipping a bunch. Oh, my God.
We'll go back. If he misses you, you know, I'm trying my best to catch some stuff, but...
So, like, for leads, can you hand me that keyboard back there?
Your signature lead.
Yeah. Yeah, so there's one sound that I've been tweaking for, like, years. I'm no good at playing the keys, but there's one sound I've been tweaking for years. I can't be giving up the entire patch here or anything, but because this lead, this will be juicy, I guess. Let's see, there might be too much latency, but I'll try it. Emotive lead. Instrument rack. I call it the emotive lead. I don't know, I just named it that a couple of years ago. I used to lead emotive too. I've been tweaking this thing forever, since like 2013, maybe. And a lot of this is popping up in the other screen, but that's okay. Right, so you got a lead, you got, you got a silence patch that I think it didn't sound anything like this initially. I think it was called, what's the initial silence patch? It was called Exposure Lead from, I think, the Definitive Collection silence patch, and I ended up just changing it a whole bunch. Then Isotope Trash, Compressor, Delay is off, and then a little Valhalla Shimmer, I think... Right. Is that too loud? I gotta come back and make sure I miss these comments. Is that too loud? Is this too loud? Can you guys hear that? Can you lower your screen size? Lower the size of me? My face? Sure. You guys don't like my face?
What's going on?
Am I getting smaller?
Oh, see, that's what people are
asking. Am I getting smaller?
Yeah. Is that too small?
Right. And this thing, so this lead... So as I've like learned to like make this lead and work with it, I've learned build up everything. I got you. Let me scroll and make sure I don't miss these things. There's so many comments I missed.
I got it. Okay.
Yeah, so this lead sound, you have to learn how to tweak it. Like I made it and it doesn't like if I press a note, it takes a while. But as it rings out, you can let it sort of ring. Here, let me demonstrate this with MIDI. Let's go like to the end of the track, right? Oh, somebody taught me how to make a MIDI clip in a really cool way the other day. That was Zach, right? Oh, sick. All right, so, like, if I just wrote this, let's go. Like, that's not going to sound so good, right? Let's do a faster one. That doesn't work too well, but with this patch in particular, it's got a really cool legato function that I sort of set up, so if this rings... Right, then it gets a right, like right, it does right, those little things anyway. And you can do it with your hands, so obviously just playing them out. But yeah, that's like the main lead sound. I can't show you all the things that are going on in there, but that's the exposure. You take the exposure lead in silent and start tweaking it up like crazy. Honestly, this lead is messy. This lead gets all over the place when I'm... So you have to do a lot. It always becomes audio, and I always end up trimming it out and stuff like that and layering it to be a little more clever. We were talking about builds, and we're going to get to builds in a second. Hang on. Let me see. Oh, my gosh. I missed so many of these.
No, you've got a lot. People are asking similar questions.
Okay. I know. I just don't want to be like have somebody be like, oh, my God, he's
build
about
up to
get to my
I told
comment.
Him, if you miss it, bug the shit out of me, and I'll find it.
How long are you trying to change everybody's straight from the computer? Okay, we missed that. Never done. Is there a general rule for leveling different parts? That's what we got. Company reverb throw, you bet. Right? Yeah, exactly. Drum fills or fills in general. Okay, we could talk about that. Yeah, okay. All right, let's. This is hard. This is tough to keep up with. All right.
Just apologize. Hey, listen, he can't get to everyone.
No,
hey,
I'm down to try. I'm down to try.
He's trying, but get to me. If he misses you, just at me and I'll try to get it in.
At what's your at?
J Perch. At J Perch if he misses it.
Okay, right. So builds. Flux Pavilion said that he spends more time on the builds than on the drops because it's important to him to make sure that you know, if you can build up the bubble, then all you gotta do is pop the bubble, right? That's easy. But if you gotta build, you know, building the bubble is a lot tougher, I think. And so there are a lot of things. Like for here, what did we do for the build? Okay, there are a couple things that we wanted to get done when doing this build, right? The idea was basically give them the vocal one more time, something to sing along to before the drop, but also start getting us into what we're going to hear in the drop, right? We want to let people know sort of what's coming without giving away too much. So the idea was to sort of keep the vocal going. Let's mute that, though. Can hear what becomes the leads in the drop, right? And you hear this guy coming in. You can see it's literally the same file, like same audio file, right? And just automated down here to come up. So the ear kind of wants that, I think. And then, okay, so I realized in doing that that it wasn't quite sticking out enough, so. Just a little more present version of it, and then I think the same thing, just reverb. Right, so then the other idea is you also gotta think about your bass in your build, right? So like, what do you want your bass to be doing? Do you want them to be having all of the bass before the drop? Not really, I mean, depending on context, you don't necessarily need to be having all of that. You want to sort of create tension in a build. So one cool trick I like to do about halfway through a build is take a sub and just start pitching it up, right? There's actually no bass in the start of this build just because you have so much effects down low, just doing that big, you know, impact there. So you have this, nothing, then halfway through the build. I don't know if you can hear that well. How about if I go like this? You'll be able to actually watch it. And that's just creating tension. That's just like telling people something's coming. Drums are pretty straightforward in a build, right? Like you want to just increase intensity, increase tension. It's a little cliche, but I think it's cliche because it works. I wish I had more already bounced out. Look, I don't know if I even am keeping this. Did I end up keeping it? Yeah, this is a cool thing to do. Take like actual like samples to fill things out, right? The song's not going to disappear without it. Honestly, you can barely even hear it. But in the context of the drums, it really goes a long way to without it. Especially you hear it start to come in. Having a little signal halfway through the build to remind people, okay, this is the downbeat, this is where things are turning up, goes a long way. And then effects are pretty straightforward, right? You just want to have like, I'm sorry this is all bounced to one stem now. Next time I'll do one where I go more in depth. And pitch should rise. A couple Kashmir impacts to start it off. I use those a lot and just some little effects to sort of make things. All right, that's enough on the builds. Yeah, what's up?
You got something? Okay. We got kick and snare and drop.
Mm-hmm.
What are your thoughts on how to get vocalist and
mm-hmm.
music theory?
Mm-hmm.
Also, what is the meaning of life? But we'll go to that later.
Nice. Not production related. Down to hit that another time. All right. Should I get some of these first? Should I keep going?
I would
order?
Just copy and paste and what people were saying you missed. But yeah, what do you got?
No. Okay. Well, no, I like that. Let me just make sure. Do you usually low pass multiple saws and place white noise in the higher register? Yes. Victon 123 nailed it. Yes. Almost always. Low pass, okay, ready, I'll do something for you guys. Unfortunately, it's all grouped, but in a drop, Where are we at here? What was this? Check this out. FabFilter. Preset. FabFilter preset on the entire Saws bus. Harshness control. Without it. With it. Just dip some of that stuff out. Makes room for the lead. So yeah, as far as the white noise, a lot of times, yes. In this one, I did it too. So in order to make that white noise, if I recall, I've bounced it out to audio and I use it a ton now. But, excuse me, the idea is basically, you can do it in Operator in Ableton. Plugins, Operator, all results. Let's see, how did I do this? Now I have it, for example, just like white noise. I just have white noise, boom.
Can you elaborate on the white noise?
Yeah.
Why it's important?
Yeah. So when you have like big, big saws in your drop, it's easy for the top to start getting like fizzy and stuff. I wonder if I could just do this. Do I have the MIDI still? Okay. Like, what is this? Okay. How about, let's try this. Let's move this. Here. So if we have, let's go biggest saw stack. This is just a virtual riot preset that I've been using lately as like as a good writing tool and also as a nice a nice core sound for the saws. So let's do this. Let's take some MIDI, pop it in there. Let's move this till later, shall we? So it's not the way of the tune, and I'll show you the idea with the white noise. So the idea is the stuff up top.
It's subtle, but it's
can really start to add up and get out of control when you start stacking multiple sources. This stuff can start to really add up, right? So say I start stacking another layer. Say I'm like, okay, I want to try to add some Omnisphere, right? To sort of fill that out a little bit. Okay, say I pull out Omnisphere. What's this one? There's one. King Quadra is a cool one. Right, okay, let's take that. We have that. Now this layer. Okay, now together. Cool, we're filling out, instead of just this, we now have this. The thing is, the top of this, the sh part, is really waving around a lot, right? So when we group them together, it's cooler to go like this. I find a lot of times, saws bus, boom. A couple dashes so it's easy to find. Send these two straight out to saws bus, and then you can go like this. Do a nice little light one of these bad boys. And then that's where you drop the white noise. I'll see if I can show you how to make it again, but I made it in Operator a little while ago, and I just use it all the time. It's gonna be super loud and aggressive at first, but hang on. Right? So you see what's going on there. And then you EQ out the bottom of that. And then you just go. The idea basically meaning that it sort of, you can replace the tops of all the things you're layering as far as your saws, because the tops might be doing different things, and have one unified, clean sort of top. Because the ear hears the tops a lot, and that's really the reasoning behind the white noise. If you want, I can go ahead and try to make it again. I think it was just like Operator, and I think you just do, what is it? Wave noise white. And then you just go to, there's something where you can like set the random all the way up and then make it stereo all the way, right? I don't remember. It was on here somewhere. But that's the idea. Anyway, let's move on. Let's do a couple other ones.
I've been reposting here. Look at what I just posted.
We got.
I'm posting it again. Look, did I go to the very bottom?
All right. Oh my God, there's so many. Oh my God, there's so many.
Go ahead. Okay. Go to the bottom. Look what I put.
Up next.
I've been like literally just writing down things that people are saying that I think maybe we.
Okay. I'm going to scroll back up and hit the other stuff too. Kick and snare and drop. Always try to level them together. What I try to do is put them in a bus together. I try to put them in a kick snare bus. And I use something called K-Clip a lot to monitor that. Unfortunately, in this project, let's group this into stream sounds. So we know how to find those. Always group your stuff. Okay, right. Kick, snare, in a drop. So, this one, like I said, unfortunately, I already bust them together, but you can do some detective work to see something kind of neat here, right? So, the idea is you want to try to keep them balanced. I like to. So, I'll throw them in a bus, throw something called K-Clip on that bus. It looks like this. And it's just a really nice sort of wall. It's just a really nice sort of ceiling that your sounds can't go past. Ableton's limiter is one. I think a lot of Ableton stock effects are really good. Ableton's limiter is horrible. It's horrendous. It makes your sounds sound like absolute garbage, and I wouldn't recommend it on my worst enemy. So I use K-Clip to sort of level out my kick snare when I put them together. I use it a lot of times for a lot of different groups. But kick snare, right? You can see that here, right? When the kick hits, when that snare hits, it's the same size, the volume, as the kick, right? And that clips. You can literally see it clipping. You can see how it. But using K-Clip is a really cool way to use to sort of make sure you have things leveled out, because you can pump up your snare a little bit more, say, and it'll make sure that's not going anywhere past that. As far as doing kick snare, a lot of times I'll sit there and I'll be like this. I'll just go like, I'll turn off the song. And I'll start going, all right, I need a snare. And I'll go like this. I'll go snare and I'll go in all results. Sometimes I'll go, I'm feeling lucky, and just go by like, look, it's on date modified. We can switch it to rank. And that's the wrong way, right? And we can take it and just go like this. I like to turn the audio down so I can hear this better.
Is there anything we can do about the phasing happening on the song audio through the stream?
Is there phasing on the song audio? Really?
I don't know.
Oh, it's probably because it's coming out of my speakers.
Okay. Oh, yeah, we don't have it going straight.
I'll just keep it quiet.
Is there a way to do that?
See if that makes it better.
Okay.
Yeah, I can do more on, like, kick snare stuff for sure. We can talk about that. But, yeah, the idea is, honestly, like, bussing them together and taking time just going through. And, like, then you got to work on side-chaining, obviously, and making sure that all works. And layering. We can talk about that. What else? What are some of the main things people are asking about that I'm missing?
If you go to mine, I have all the bullet points.
Jay Perch, you have a bunch here.
I just keep reposting the same thing.
But also, okay, can you use the same kick and snare throughout the whole song? Do you alternate for snare versus verses? Okay, that's a really good question. Right, so in this song, I end up using the same kick and not the same snare. So, because sometimes, sometimes you have a kick that's going to annihilate your entire bus. Like for example, this song is one of those. This kick is big. Right, so like if I wanted to make a little one of these, like those little things. That's gonna be a lot. That just takes up the entirety of the mix, right? Because the kick is so weighty, it has such a long decay. So in a case like that, I'll use a little something different to fill that in. But in earlier parts of the songs, for example, in this case, I ended up using the same kick earlier in the tune, in the verse when it comes in. Nope, earlier. But the snares are different, right? I have a whole snares bus, and I don't know what I had here. What I have now, some up. Because having that thing from the drop would have been way too aggressive. For example, if we went like that here.
I didn't think that the
That ain't it. I've heard a lot of songs these days by some big artists that sound that heavy-handed. I don't like it. I think we can do better. So anyway, yeah, different throughout the song.
What about layering with percussion?
Yeah, so here you can see it already in the snare. You've got a few different ones, right? You got that little kind of thing. But cymatics is really good for, cymatics gets a lot of heat, and I think part of that might have to do with the way that people use it. But I think one of the ways that I like to use cymatics is for their little percussion knocks. Just a little, like, you know, that little transient is really nice in cymatics packs. So I'll use that there to just to get that little sharp attack. And that's going to make it sound a bit more natural. And same with this. Can you guys hear that? I hope you guys can hear that. Is it too low? No, it's low for us.
Yeah, okay.
Because I'm trying to make sure it doesn't phase out too much. Yeah. I like what I Am Stratosphere says. Yeah, you can use a shorter sidechain for a snare drum. That's a big thing, too. It depends on the pulse. For this song, I use the same sidechain for everything because the snare is layered with the kick. So you're getting the kick on all the beats. So I wanted it to sort of be even. But that's the thing. What else am I missing here?
Let's stay in the production. So chord structure on saws, music theory with chords, and then one more. Lead on main sound. Lean on main sound versus super saw stack.
Okay. So as far as leads, we talked a little bit about that, and like you can hear it here. So as far as layering leads, I use that emotive lead a lot of times for like my main sound. But then I'll do, ooh, do I have the MIDI? I wonder if I have the MIDI. I could even show you how that works. But I'll try to get a more focal sound. This looks like that might be it.
Is Midas in the building?
He might be.
Joe, are you in the building?
That's my boy.
What up?
Hey.
What up, Joe?
So I'll take like, that's my boy, Joe. That's my boy. I'm always going to say that when he hops in the chat. That's my dog. Stream sounds what it is. Ho!
The boy chick.
Joe just picked up a whole bunch of vodka at his place up in Philadelphia. Dude, bro, man, that's what's up. Midas got a collab with Illenium. No, Midas got a collab with Trivecta. What? Yeah, better. Anyway, so I'll take that lead sound. Where did I put it? Did I delete it? Did I delete my lead sound? Hope I didn't delete my lead sound. It's okay, because we can always pull it back. Instruments, emotive lead. Right, so here you go. As far as lead layering is concerned, you can take like this guy. This is the one that we talked about, right? Hopefully this is the right MIDI. I don't feel like this is. That's not quite right. But you can take it, and so for like, I think for this song, I added it I took that MIDI and put it into another one that felt a bit more sort of forward and in your face. Do I have the funky lead? Funky lead. Funky lead is another virtual Riot lead that just layers really nicely and does a nice kind of thingy on it. A little too much. You put them together. One's filling up the side, sounding nice and rippy, and the other one's like nice and forward and tight. So you do that, and then you do the saws, or you do them in reverse order, and then you have too much sound, and then you need to carve away, and that's where things get to be a pain in the ass. And so then you just got to figure out what your focus sound is. What do you want them to hear the most? Usually it's like that main sound, like the lead or the vocal. Like, if you listen, like the saws here do not sound... It sounds fine like that, but if I go like this... No, wait a second.
What's the first serum there?
Great question. Serum is... The Funky Lead is literally a virtual Riot pack. Let me pull that bad boy out. Here she comes. This guy. Lead Funky Lead. Hang on. Why is this not working? Is it gonna work? Yeah. I thought I could play it on the keyboard. Maybe not. Ah. Yeah, I would highly recommend that lead sound. That's really neat. It's a little, like, in your face. It's a little aggressive sometimes. But it's really cool for harmonies. Like, oh, I don't know. I don't know. We can talk about that another time. I don't want to go too far on a tangent of just making things here. I guess maybe that might be interesting content. Maybe. Okay, Perch, what do we got to do? Where are we at here?
Okay.
Oh, my God. I missed so much. I feel bad.
Okay, limiter and volume. Max dB difference between drops and verses.
Max dB difference between drops and verses. Yeah. It depends. It depends if it's a...
Also, chord structure.
Oh,
how
yeah.
You come up with them. But you've talked about how you use the guitar a lot.
Yeah,
but,
a lot of times it's guitar. Like, I know, for example, Joe Midas, I know, uses the keys a lot, like piano, to come up with his chords. And I'll do that with the guitar a lot. Like, I feel like if you have a way that you can, that you're, like, used to making sound or create or contributing music to the world, like an instrument, use that to come up with something and try to find a way to translate that into what it is that you're doing. You know, that, and so for me, like, guitar becomes a big part of it. That's not that helpful. That's helpful as far as procedural. But as far as what the chords do, you know, different songs obviously have different vibes and call for different things. But
he'll have, like, chord sessions where he'll just, like, come up with different chords and melodies. And then sometimes, like, if it's, like, finalized, he'll go straight to Ableton. But a lot of times I've seen him just marinate on a chord progression. Like, every time I see him, he'll add a little thing to his little... chord progression. Like, I think the thing that he was working on last Twitch stream, the one where he's playing the guitar and going to Ableton, he's been working on that chord progression for like 6 months, 8 months. He's had that marinating in his head. So I feel like...
Yeah, so I think, like, a lot of times I'll take the guitar and just, like, use a voice memo to knock down little chord ideas. And then one day I'll be like, all right, that sounds cool. Let's try to plug that into MIDI and try to turn it into some different sounds. If you don't use an instrument, I think that's completely reasonable as well. And I think, excuse me, you can do a lot of really cool things. You can just use 9 chords, like Joe's saying there, and things like that. But, you know, you can just do the old Skrillex method of just using the little thing and just popping them in. To me, I heard Flux Pavilion say another thing from Flux Pavilion years ago about, what did he say? That he makes his songs usually in very simple sounds, like a massive init patch, and then writing it like that. So you use a sound where your sound is not going to make up for, you know, like, not interesting writing, right? So if it translates in a crappy sound, it's probably going to be good. And I think I was saying that about that biggest saw stack, like this guy right here. It can be really neat for that. See that white noise up and up? If it sounds good on there, then you can add other sounds based off that. So you try to make it sound good in a simple way. If you guys have specific questions about chords, we could talk about that, you know? Oh my gosh, there's so many questions in the chat. Yeah, extending your chords is really nice. Using, like, extended chords, sometimes you want that vibe, sometimes you don't, you know? Like, for example, I referenced this last night, like, my tune Break Me has a bunch of these different sort of chord extensions, and other times that's kind of unnecessary. Shatterpoint, for example, doesn't have many at all. I wanted to keep it more down to the basic triads, but now we're getting into music theory and stuff like that. But, like, I don't know, like, the first chord in Break Me is a 7th chord, and the lead is focusing on the 7th. So, like, and it's not even the 1 chord in the key. So you can get away with a lot if you, you know. Love you, Joe. Have fun, man. Go enjoy the beverage. Let's talk later. Let's do something. All right, Perch, where am I at? What did I miss? Oh, my God. Oh, hey, guys, feel free to drop your questions again. Drop them again if I missed them. Drop them again down here and tell me or Perch, and we'll try to get around to responding to you guys. Right? Where are we at here? Oh, my gosh. I don't know where to start.
Okay. Where do you usually cut the frequencies? High pass off on your mid basses? How much saturation, if any, do you add to your subs?
Cool. I don't saturate my subs all that much. I will. Actually, the newest EP, I'm going to use every stream to plug this tune a little bit, huh? Leave It All Behind, which is going to be the lead single of the new EP. I had to saturate the sub a lot because it sounded no good because the first note is a freaking D. And the song is not in D, it's in F sharp minor or A. And the first drop is a D on the first note. And it honestly didn't sound good. Like, you can go low D. You really can. You can do that. Especially a lot of, like, heavy dubstep tunes do. But I don't know. It just wasn't quite working when I was trying it. Yeah.
Did you talk about, like, vocalists? Well, first of all, there's a difference between now and when you first
right.
started finding vocalists. I already wrote in the chat that, like, you walked into a coffee shop and found Connor Switch.
Yeah.
But they're really curious on how you find vocalists. I know you've talked about it, but obviously.
Yeah. For vocalists, that can be all over the place. Like, sometimes you get a vocal from a big vocalist after all this time. He's like, hey, let's work. But a lot of times it's something completely random. Like, One Night Only was my first release, and that was Johanna lives like right down the road, and I saw Connor Zwetch from Believe in a coffee shop right down the road, and we got in touch and started trying to work, and she sent me a bunch of works in progress that she had been working on, and one of them had the line, I believe something, 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 and then something, it's all I want to do, and I was like, all right, let's just chop around, see if we can find anything, and eventually we had something. So it can be super simple like that, like this. Okay, two polar opposites. One, on the new EP, there's one song called Wasteland, mm-hmm. and on the song Wasteland, this song got pitched to me by my publisher, who said, hey, there are all these vocalists that are sending vocals around, see if you're interested in any of these, and a lot of times I'm not too big on them. A lot of them are pretty poppy, a little too poppy for me, but this one I thought was really cool and was able to work with that. But on the complete other hand, Leave It All Behind from... Leave It Hybrid. There's a hybrid master. On this tune, there is the vocalist is my brother's college roommate, who my brother was in a band with, like, you know, and also my old bandmate laid down a harmony, you know, on the tune, like. What do you go? And he sounds great. That's Homeboy, who's my brother's college roommate, you know? Like, so you can find vocalists all over the place that you just got to sort of, I think, be open-minded about it and try to find people who jive with the vision. Where are we at?
Okay, so how important is it to change your chord progression in different sections?
How important is it to change your chord progression in different sections?
Yes.
It depends on the song. Some songs work really well as the same chord progression the whole song. Deadmau5 comes to mind. He does a really good job of that, but he's also really good at making what I call magic loops, which are chord progressions that can just keep repeating and you don't get sick of them. There's, I think, a sort of a bit of an art and a science to that. To
I got
creating
a couple
that
I want to answer now.
Go ahead.
But
sometimes I think I like switching it up. Like, yo, I got this one unreleased tune. I'm going to play another time called Ocean Spirit that not only changes chord progressions, but changes key. And I think that's really neat. Like, Labyrinth did the same thing. It changed modes. And I think it all depends really what you're going to do. Like, the new EP, I keep bringing up the new EP, but not a single song stays on the same chord progression the whole time, you know? And I think that really makes things feel a bit more songy. In a dance context, that doesn't always work. So it's all about what you're going for. I know that, like, the new EP, when people are listening to it shows, it's going to be more vibe and feels. They're not as much going to be dancing to it. They might just sort of be bobbing, and that's okay, but you got to be prepared for that with, you know, using a bunch of different chords and stuff like that.
Okay, I would love for you to talk about this too. I got two things. So the falling, where did you get the vocal and falling from?
Ooh,
I've heard the falling fading down, down, down clip.
Yeah.
A lot of different songs.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know about that, but what, and then elaborate on what saturation means. How does it differ from compression or distortion?
We can do them at the same time. So, Falling was a vocal from the Ronit sample pack. I wonder if I could find it. But it didn't end up being just that. We ended
is
up...
Falling... Someone said Falling is on Splice. Did someone put
yep,
that
up? Yep, it's from Splice.
Oh, it's from hers.
Yeah, it's from her...
Changed.
Yeah. I don't know if I still have the vocal... Oh, come on. I would like to try to show you how that worked, because that was kind of neat. Chad from Tritonal actually told me something that made that idea sort of come to mine. I mean, we could download it. Should we just download the vocal and just try it again? Yeah. All right. Let's go to Splice. Splice.com. Sounds.
Oh, I was confusing this one for Ghost of a Friend.
What? You want it, what's the idea?
Vocal, you know, the vocal from Ghost of a Friend. The, like, the distorted one.
Oh, yeah. Was someone asking about that?
No, I just, when they asked about this one, I was falling. Thinking about Falling.
All right, let's download this. We're going to re-download the Falling phrase on Splice. Let's try this. Splice. See if this works. So. Oh, I got the, I didn't get the dry one. Okay, so y'all want to see something? All right, let's try it. So as far as making, right, so here's the original idea. The original sound. Oh, did I?
Into the Light remix is great.
Falling, fading.
Right.
Down, down, down I go.
Right, so that was the original thing. I should have taken the dry one. Should I just download the dry one real fast? Let's see. Because it ended up with one of the dry. Let's try this. Ronit. Falling. Dry. Go there. Whatever. Can't find it. Let's just work. So you warp it. I think it says it's 130. Boom. Like that. And then this is what I ended up doing, was you take Waves Tune, which is a quick, ew. Alright, we gotta work on. No license. I do have a license. Y'all are just trying to make it sound like I don't. Boom. This one should work. Nice.
Falling, fading.
Right? So... what did we do here? So this will take your notes. So you can take these and literally... Right? And then was it from... What were the chords, right? Right? Yeah. And then you can go like this, ready? You take it, you duplicate the track. Okay? You do a new wave tune. And you can start making chords with this. And this is where things get really interesting.
Falling.
Let's try this.
Falling.
How about just one of these that stays down on the root?
Falling. Fading.
We're going to do the same thing on that one. Let's just keep it all down. I know it's going to sound bizarre, but in context, hang on.
Falling, fading.
These guys, put them together. Not, we're not gonna be there yet, but hang on.
Falling, fading.
Right, then you can start doing different ones. No, granted, hang on. Ready?
Falling,
you're gonna get weird phasing artifacts, falling, so you're gonna have to deal with that. But, one more.
Falling.
Let's try this. Let's try going down.
Falling.
Yeah, hang on. Yeah, we can do it. Anyway.
Falling.
And you start to put these things all together.
Falling.
You know what I'm saying?
Falling.
And then you eventually can stack all these things, and what you do is you can you start making these chords. And then I end up doing a sub-bass below it to try to fill it all out. Then you can saturate. So saturation, I think the difference between saturation is, and like compression, is you have saturation, I guess, like distorts the sound, right? And it's like a light distortion. It's a cool way to bring things up and make them sound louder without using just a dynamic range adjustment, if that makes sense, right? So I could compress this. Heavy. Which is cool too, but you can also saturate it instead and get like.
Can you use the same thing with vocal synth?
I've never tried Bubbles since.
There's so many different ways to do the same thing.
I went down a rabbit hole there.
Yeah.
I know. All right. Where are we at?
Okay. Tips on making dreamy soundscapes for intros, fills, breakdowns on drops. Interesting. How do you come up with your interesting fills?
Pain in the
ass. Breakdowns.
Pain in the ass.
And then dreamy soundscapes. I mean, dreamy soundscapes for the intro. Like, he does a really good job with these outros too. Like, if you guys really, most people focus on the outros. Those outros really take you somewhere, I think. But his intros are similar too. But I'm talking for him now.
You're good. I appreciate that. One cool way to make a cool thing with, if you even just want to get the vibe of the song set up, sometimes for an intro, I'll have like a rough idea and then I'll leave it and then I'll take something. Okay, so let's do this. Let's do it with freaking Alive. Like, for you guys, still hear that? Okay, does that still work volume wise? Someone give me a yes if it works volume wise. Perfect. All right. So intro was, let's say, intro was basically like what I was just saying. So I had an idea that I wanted to sort of get straight into the vocal, but before that, I knew I needed some sort of something to lead in. And a lot of times I won't do that all right away. A lot of times I'll wait for the song to present an answer. So I think one of the important things, if you're playing in a band with people, you need to be able to listen to them. And I used to play in a jam band, and I think one of the coolest things, this is a good bit of advice, I think, is that, like, when I played in a jam band, one of the ideas is that you're improvising for a lot of the set. And if you're just trying to come up with ideas, you're inevitably going to run out of ideas. So, I mean, it's okay to come up with your own ideas and sit there and try to do that. But it's as important, if not more important, to listen to the other musicians, right? So that was something that we always try to keep in mind, is if you're listening to the other guys, you'll never run out of ideas. If you're listening to what's going around you, there's always ideas around you to be pulled out of the air. So I try to take that same approach when working on a song. Sometimes I'm better at it than other times. But a lot of times the idea is, if you're working on the song, see if you can't try to figure out when the song is suggesting something to you. So in this case, I took the vocal and I was playing with it, working on one section, and I ended up reversing one part, and I was like, oh my God. Why do we not hear that? You should hear that. Ah. I think that's actually just part of the, if we flip that, I think that's something you might recognize her doing in the song. Yeah, that's just part of what she's doing over the drop. But in this case, when it got reversed, I was like, maybe we should start the song with that. Other times it'll work differently. Other times I'll take out Omnisphere and just go into some crazy patches and try to make something cool that sounds sweet. Other times I'll take a vocal, throw a bunch of reverb, and try to do something like that. For Leave It All Behind, it was a similar idea. I had a sort of, which you guys will hear on the EP, I had an idea. Leave it all, don't leave it all. I had this thing. And I thought, why don't I take that exact melody, distort it, make it real small, and give you a hint in the beginning. So just processing, for me, a lot of times it comes down to just processing ideas that already exist within the song, and using that to sort of create an ambience that is going to set you up for the rest.
All right.
What do we got?
Someone was talking about Believe,
yeah.
Which I really like,
mm-hmm.
as well.
Mm-hmm.
I was trying to make him play it all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So Believe, how do you make your chop sample so clean?
Mm.
Also, jam band scene displays.
Yeah, who said that?
Well, someone was talking about the jam band scene. And
yeah.
I just doing displays.
Displays, yeah, that was the band. Yeah, so vocal chops are very tedious.
That is one of the earlier ones, Believe,
mm-hmm.
and the one before Believe.
One Night Only,
you had some phenomenal, I feel like
some
you
chops.
Spent hours on the
Yeah, team. I used to spend a lot more time doing vocal chops than I do now. I should get back into that sometime, but I think a lot of the idea when I do vocal chops was always, like, I try to write a melody and have a melody in mind already, and then I'll try to replicate that melody with the vocal chops. So sometimes I'll say, okay, well, I have a melody, and so, okay, the vocal is doing this. I'll say, all right, Let's try to play. We need an E. Does the vocal ever do an E? Let's go through the vocal, try to figure out what the notes are, playing on the guitar. Hey, vocal goes to E. Okay, we need an F sharp here. Oh, vocal never goes to an F sharp, but it does go to a G. Let's pitch it down one and try to put it there. Then you have, like, eventually you have a whole rough idea of a vocal chopped out, replacing your melody, and then you can sort of go in and replace it with different samples to make them sound better. And that's really what it was with Believe, and then just processing it the same way. But, like, for Believe, like, I remember in the drop, there was da-na-na-na, and, like, for that, it was like, or in the call, I think I was just playing that on the guitar, and I just tried to do the same thing, where I just took the vocal and try to make them do the same notes as the melody would be done, right? Is that helpful? I think. I hope I'm trying to give you guys, I'm trying to go over enough things, but also, and we will post, for somebody asking about leads, when we already hit leads, we'll get back to this stuff. We definitely will. We'll put this stuff all back up. Perch, where are we at? Where are we at here? Who are you? What have I ignored? What about? Cool. Thank you, Big Tom.
We were talking about Chronicles, and I was asking if people were going.
One thing, I'm trying to get into bass music, and the one thing I never get right are the chords. How do you typically go about layering chord stacks? Am I hijacking? Sure,
we
were supposed to be on something.
No, we were just shooting the shit.
Do you specifically, how do you typically go about layering chord stacks? Do you specifically look for similar patches? Do you purposefully layer different sounding stacks? Yeah, it depends. It depends. So, if I want it to sound pretty straightforward, yeah, I have some distinct sounds. I use that biggest saw stack patch I played. I use that Anjuna pad a lot, and I use a lot of, like, Omnisphere and Nexus pads to fill it out. Like, I can show you this. I hope this is still split out. Yeah, it's not MIDI anymore, but you can hear what the different patches do. Ready? So here's... This was like, this started off as like a 1788L style bass that learned to work with the chords of the song. Now it doesn't sound anything like that, but. Right? So then, that's your biggest saw stack together. They sound pretty whack, right? So we're gonna add sub. I don't know if you can hear that. Sub always sounds weird in the stream. So the thinking behind that was I used an Omnisphere patch to try to find something that would give you the lead note. So I felt like here we're just getting... We are still getting the lead note, but we're getting a lot of chord. And I wanted you to hear the lead a little more too. And I wanted to use a sound that was a little more unique and not such a virtual instrument sound. Something that felt a little more organic. Something that sort of painted the sides. And something that says, okay, what is that? That's neat. So you put that... Right? It's almost like a cool sort of whistle. You put them together. Getting better, but we're not there yet. So then you take, we want a little more to go, dun, 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 right? So that's where I took a little grand piano or something in Nexus, right? Sounds whack by itself, but if it was doing all the other stuff and you layered it with everything else, you're going to start running into trouble. But so here's the deal. So, right, like if you just went into that, my ass kicked out of the club playing something like that. So then more of that, I thought we wanted a little more attack. So together, those guys get the job done. Right? You know what I'm saying? And then we're almost there. And then you get a little bit of this Anjuna pad I use a lot. It's just a silence patch in the Definitive Collection patch. Very similar to the VR, the Virtual Riot Biggest Saw Stack. The Virtual Riot one is much more aggressive. But to me, it feels a little plastic. It feels a little sterile. It doesn't put me in my feels. The Anjuna pad does. But doesn't have the balls and the sort of push that the Virtual Riot one does. So, what's your solution? Layer them. Almost there. Put them all together. We're getting pretty good. Except we have none of what Davin laid out for us. So Davin put out a little guitar in the beginning. There's our magic spice. You put what Davin laid down because this is a remix and we want a little bit of the soul of the original. So you put them all together and bada bing. Right? Let's turn it off. Do we have anything else going there? So Then it's just vocal and effects, really. This is doing a little. Now it starts to pulse to side chain to make room with the snare. But that's the idea. Hey, right? I thought that was pretty cool, guys. We can do more stuff like that. I can go into some project files earlier and show you guys more layering stuff because that stuff's pretty fun. Where else we at, Purge?
All right, what do we got here? We got. Actually, go to the bottom
of the chat. I mean, Elenium Mixed Chat.
I just posted something.
We are recording. Next, method for creating pads, ambience, psytrance, dark attune, shatterpoint. Okay, yeah. So I can show you guys this. I'll show you what goes on as far as like pads and stuff like that. This is that Anjuna pad that I use a lot. Let's drop it. Same chords. So a lot of times this is how I'll start. If I want to make a pad section for a song, I'll be like, okay, I have the MIDI I already wrote out. Let's try it on some other sounds. That's a big one. Like, here's my sound, or here are my notes. Let's try this on different sounds, see what else we got. So, audio, I think it's in favorites, right? And Juno pad. I never know how to play that stuff. Boom. Okay, literally just a silence patch from the Definitive Collection. Responsive to the cutoff, right? It also sounds really nice in high octaves. Also sounds really nice in lower octaves. This might be a little too notey. You know, we got a bunch of notes going, so it might sound busy down low, however. Busy. So for that, if we got to a place like that, I would probably. Anyway, yeah, that's. And then I'll take Omnisphere. Then I'll take like Omnisphere and try to try some different things. I'll try to take some vocal ambiences and stuff like that. I'll use Paul Stretch. Things like that. All right, Perch, what else was next?
I just posted.
Notes during chord sax. I guess we didn't do notes just now. Let's see. Same chords. Didn't we talk about that, right? Having the same chords of the song. Lead and Riptide. Yeah, I did do an In the DAW about Riptide. If you guys want, we can do another session. I don't want to try to open up another project right now because I'm worried about just...
Those In the DAWs. Sorry. Whoever doesn't know what those In the DAWs are, they're really good. Mm-hmm. He does a great job. What's his name?
Wyatt. Yeah.
Does a great job.
You know, he said the Sky's cousin.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, check out the In the DAW videos when you go in.
If you go to his YouTube channel, he has them linked there. There's like three or four of them.
Can you link In the DAW? Perch? Just Google In the DAW. Try
just
that.
Go to
YouTube. Oh, no. Can, yeah. He's asking if he can. Yeah. Drop it in. Drop those links. Drop that in. That's right. Yeah. How do you experiment, push the fold with leads? Perch, I'm just reading the newest one, so I need you to help me.
They've slowed down. It's gotten a lot easier, so you're good.
Okay.
That's the newest
one. Show us the Psy.
You know what? Did you talk about Psy? Hold on.
No, I haven't. Let's do that for a separate one, because I don't want to worry. The project file is going to... If I start switching between, I'm worried about this getting unstable. Yeah. I'll do this. We can do it. I don't want to do too much now, because we'll do these, like, weekly. We're stuck inside because of the coronavirus. So let's keep it to one at a time, like, song-wise. But we'll open up other ones and go through them on the next one. We'll do another one later in the week. I'm down to keep doing more of these. These could be a lot of fun. You were able to release songs with both of the grand chefs of bass, Excision and Seven Lines last year. How were you able to build relationships with the biggest name in the game? I was able to meet Jeff because he found, Seven Lines, because he found Chatterpoint, and then we just got to talking, and then I remixed Without You, My Love. And then we got to talking more, and then Wooly hit me up because him and Jeff were working on Island, and I, you know, hopped in to help with that. Excision was through Wooly. Wooly was working on a bunch of stuff with Excision, and so we made that connect right there. What am I missing? I feel like I'm missing.
You're on.
No, dude, there was some way up here.
I promise, man. Like, some of them aren't questions. I'm going through.
I know, but there was stuff.
Hey, if we missed something, just at me, I'll get it. But I don't think we did.
Yeah, dreamy soundscapes on intros. Let's see. I don't know. Fills slash breakdowns on drops. Breakdowns on drops. Maybe or drops. Fills can be a lot of fun. So like, let's wrap up soon. Let's get like a couple more. But
do you want to show some works in progress? People are asking it before you get off.
We'll do that separate. We're gonna do we'll do a works in progress one. It'll be fun. It'll be good to switch these. I'm sorry, keep them split up a little bit. But as far as making fills, here's a really neat trick, and I did it with this song. Let's see. Where is it now? Oh, here. Ooh. Yeah, all right. Okay, ready? For a cool idea for effects or for fills and stuff like that. See if anybody in here can tell me what this is from. If anybody's got a real good ear, see if you can say what song that's from. Because that's one of my tunes right there. It's a pretty popular one. A lot of y'all probably know it. Not Island. Come on, but that's about as close as it gets. It's Falling. It's Wooly from. It's like the drop, but I think I probably pitched it up a couple. Let's see. Hang on. Wait. What if I pitch this down 4 to the key? That's. Doesn't sound like it anymore because we messed with it. But I'll take little parts of my tunes, and entire parts of the track and chop them up and put them in the new track. You can get a lot of really cool effects. Access, I'll do that with all the time, though. As a matter of fact, check this out. Do I have it? So, okay, when I was making Riptide, I took my Access drop. It was all on an F, I think. Right, that little thing. And I took it and I just repitched it to follow the chords of Riptide so I could drop it in and use it in Riptide in like different parts. So like, I think I probably moved this to 160, didn't I? Because that's what Riptide was. Yeah. So then like, but like. That's literally, if you drop it with Riptide, it lines up perfectly with the drop, but it's the notes, it's the basis from Axis. So taking things that you have done that you think sound really cool, you can repurpose them into your new things, and that can help you. Yeah, I did that in the DAW, yeah. You can use that to save time. You can also use that, though, to make your sound feel really cohesive and sort of bring sounds you've already introduced into your other works. What else?
Let's talk
We're almost done. We're almost done. I'm going to wrap soon.
What you learned from Jeff, and I feel like you can incorporate that with what you've learned from Jake. And all of
yeah, Jeff Seven Lions, Jeff.
Yes.
So much. Jeff's like a freaking LeBron James in the sense that like when you play on a basketball team with LeBron James, he like levels everybody up, and like Jeff Montalvo does that as well. He like when you work with him, he sort of raises the standard and really helps everybody do a really good job. One thing I learned from Jeff was. I remember working on Island, and I remember when he was just like, "This, yeah, I think this part's done. Let's move on. What are we doing on this part?" And I was like, wow, I sit and sometimes tweak parts of songs all the way till the very end, all the way till the very end. And you're like, all right, sometimes that's good, but sometimes it's not. And I was really kind of, that was kind of neat how Jeff was like, no, this part is done. Let's move on. And it was really nonchalant, but it made me be like, okay, wait, I should probably do that more. I should probably like, just understand when this part is done and just move on to the next part of the song. And that was one really cool thing. Another thing that I picked up from Jeff and from Adam from working with both of them is making sure that drops don't confuse people, that things sort of make sense. Like my first demo for the Island drop, I thought was really cool, but it was really choppy right away. And Jeff said something like I want to give people time for them to take in all the sound that you're giving them before you pull it back away. And so little things like that, right?
What about Jason Ross?
What about Jason Ross? Jason Ross, the homie.
Yeah.
Jason's my boy. Jason's my dog. Jason's one of the people that I think I share the most works in progress and stuff with. Jason and I share a lot. We bounce a lot of stuff back and forth.
Methods for creating... Oh, sorry. Wrong one. Never mind. Just kidding. Oh, silent over serum.
Both. Actually, good question. I actually feel like if you want to make your sounds, especially like your saws and your chords sound really nice, it can help to layer multiple sound sources. So in other words, if you have... you can if you're really good at it, but personally, it doesn't work that well when I try to do, like, four sounds all from Silent or all from Serum. Like, it's cool to take something from Silent, something from Nexus, something from Atmosphere, something from Serum, because all of those sort of synths or samplers have their own way of filling out the sound stage or stereo field. So you put them all together, you know?
Do you remember if you sampled Axis and Talk?
I did sample Axis and Talk. Yeah, I think I did, actually. Yeah.
How do you guys like Talk, man? That's like my favorite drop of all time.
I have not tried out Faceplant. Thanks, man. I'm glad you like Talk. Yeah, Axis does have little bits of Talk and stuff like that. Yeah, the Bua Capo in the, excuse me, those little
drop chops. 258-219-5189 layered synth.
Thanks, man.
What is that?
Oh my god, my million layered synths. I know, Yetep. Shout out Yetep, my man. Fano, is that the same key as Afterlife? It is. I should try mixing that. But yeah, did it use the vocal in the lead? Yeah. Yo, actually the Talk drop layering was a pain in the ass as far as all that. Oh my god, Chronic makes a good point. Bamboozle playing the Talk visual in the background. Yeah, it's the interesting thing when you run into, when you don't get to bring your own VJ on the road, sometimes they just take whatever you gave them and they'll just drop the one visual at the one time. And yeah, I had to scrub Talk because they cut my set for Thunderdome. They cut everybody's set. Everybody's set's got like, so I had to cut a bunch of stuff out. But as far as the Talk drop, that was interesting. That drop went through so many different, oh my God, I wonder if I can pull up old versions.
Falling versus Having.
I don't think so, no.
Master Chain?
Talk. I originally called it, what was it? Cold Trees. I think was the drop idea. Do I have old versions of it? I don't know if any of you know
where. Sorry, I like this. You're probably the only DJ that can stop the music and talk all nerdy on the mic. People at the Thunderdome are loving it.
Yeah, hey, yeah, man. Come on.
That's the boy. He's not fake. He just rocks. He'll stop the music and talk to you guys like this.
Yeah, Talk drop went all over the place. Like, one idea was trying something like what I did. This was old. This was super old. But it was like the idea of maybe the Fractures lead. Kind of saying da 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 da. Yeah, that might have worked as a second drop, but I never. What did this one do?
Yeah,
this one had a lot of guitar.
That was like my shit.
Did it have a vocal here? No, so there is no vocal at this point. Does this have a drop? Yeah, I wasn't doing it. So this was something that I was talking about with Jeff from Seven Lions. Like, what, you know, he pointed my attention when we were working on Island on making sure that you're not confusing your fans. Like that, the chords come on a weird beat. You don't have enough time to take in the chords. It sounds kind of whiny. This song was a pain in the ass to dial in to get from that to like... But that was, I think, where the idea sort of came down. Master, do I have it on here? Yeah. Sometimes I have to like download my own songs. Whoops. Right, so if you compare sort of how they ended up filling out, usually you can find the drop, right? Because it ends up being right around there. To go from that side. Ooh, that fell down there. From like... Right. But you weren't getting enough of the chords. Now. So one big thing I realized was like, okay, when that snare came in, do us. Like, I wanted you to get the chords. Problem is, lead comes in after that. I love doing it. Right? I wanted that lead to come in after. So that was a pain in the ass. How do you put the chords in? Well, you could make the chords not so loud that, you know, that the lead has room to come in. Okay, but I do that, but then the chords sounded underwhelming when they came in with the snare. Back to your boy Jason Ross, came up with a brilliant idea. He said sidechain the chords to the lead. So in talk, the chords are actually sidechained to the lead. So you'll hear the chords come in with a snare, and then the chords come in. But as soon as the little lead comes in, the chords get a little bit quieter. So that's how I ended up filling that up. Oops, wrong one, old one. So like, right, so anyway, that was very tedious, that song. That was a lot of, like, coming back each day, trying to fill things out, trying to make them sound better.
I got something for you.
What's that?
Read the last one there. Here we go.
I love this shit, guys.
No, not that.
Yeah, Perch is the kind of friend everyone needs in their life.
Oh, hey, thanks, that's man.
Do you think it's smart to pay for mastering? I do. I do. However, okay, so an interesting thing, like, certain songs, like, I don't know. I'll basically, with my songs, I'll do everything besides the master. Some songs I will master. Ghost of a Friend I mastered, Deep End I mastered. This Alive remix I actually ended up mastering. There's a weird one where on this new EP, there's one song that doesn't sound good on the drop of the master. It's Leave It All Behind. It's the title track. Doesn't sound good. I'm not the title track, but the first single. Always just full master, to answer your question. It's always just like a full pre-master I send out and have that master. I never send stems for the master.
How do you do a louder like, how do you make the master louder without squashing it?
We'll talk about that. Pain in the ass. pain in the ass, especially for melodic music. Wow. But for Leave It All Behind, it's actually interesting because there are a few parts, specifically the drop, that just don't sound any good with a master. And I've gotten multiple masters, and like the rest of the EP sounds so good with a master, but just the drop and Leave It All Behind always gets messed up when I get a master done. So the final version on the EP is fully mastered, except the drop is just unmastered. It just like cuts to that. So, and there's other parts that cut in and out, and it sounds great. It sounds fine. Island was like that too, actually. Island had something like that too. I feel like the drop was a totally different
stem master or wave master.
Yeah, I never do stem master. I never send out like my own stems to have that mastered. I always leave my mix the way it is and just have a little bit of. The best ones always end up being pretty similar in master to what my pre-master sounded.
Tips for mixing.
Oh, we've had a whole stream of those.
Oh, did you?
I mean, this, right? No, I guess not. I mean,
well, he's recording this whole thing. Hey, if you got in here late, he's going to repost this whole entire thing.
Yeah, yeah.
And make clips, too, so you don't have to go through.
I don't know. There's all sorts of ones for mixing, right? I mean, oof. Oh, man. I don't even know to start. I'll say one. Yeah, I'm down to wind down. I don't know. We already did. We did tracks. track spacer is really cool. Yeah. So what I'm status here said is correct. And as a matter of fact, I didn't know about track spacer when I did that thing in talk. So I would have probably tried. I would have probably tried track spacer now. Track spacer is wild. Yeah. What else? Am I missing anything? How to use mid side EQ? That can be a whole thing. Yeah. Yeah. Kepik is right. It's great for dipping Vox and for dipping things around. Vox. Mid-side EQ, I'll use, like, for example, in the master. Something got us divided. You can take the sides, for example, and go in and be like, alright, mid-side, sides, and make sure. Like on this one, I didn't do it. I coulda bought myself a little headroom by doing one of these numbers on your sides. Because you don't really need all that sub in your sides, right? Sometimes you can get real creative with it. Like sometimes I'll have like a main vocal sitting in the middle and I want to like, and my pads are more based around the sides. So I'll scoop some of the vocal range out of the middle. I'll scoop some of where the vocals sit, you know, out of the middle of my pads, but still let that be okay on the sides to sort of focus your ear into that pocket. That's one way of doing things. AU5 is straight up a legend. I absolutely agree. Sup, Justin42. Hope you feel better. Yeah, you can use a limiter for all that stuff. All right, I'm rapping. We did a lot. I don't want to do too much at one time.
That was like one after. That was like bang. Yeah, we went rapid fire for 90 right minutes.
That was
man.
One of the best wow. ones. That was good. That was good. You guys are good. Yeah, that was focused.
It's a lot.
Anyhow,
that is a lot.
We'll do more. We'll do more. We'll do more throughout the ensuing weeks. I'm down to do a lot more of these. What I'm going to do, what I'm going to keep doing, is dropping these clips into the Twitch so you guys can go back and seeing little highlights. I'll also leave up the full video. Thank you guys so much. I'm going to put them in maybe on YouTube too so you can flip through them there. And feel free. Hey, the stuff I'm talking about now, feel free to hop on the Discord. There's a link, I think, right? Isn't there? There's a link in the Trivected Tribe, or if you go to my Instagram on the link tree, in the link in bio, there's a link to Discord there. So the Trivected Tribe Facebook group has a link to the Discord. My Instagram has a link to the Discord. I've been posting it on Twitter. So I don't know. Somebody else posted. There you go. Fauno posted it. Go in there. We have production talk in the Discord, and y'all can talk about that on there. So anyway, give me feedback. Let me know in the Discord, on Twitter, anywhere, Instagram, what you guys think we could be doing better for the next ones. And I love you guys. I'm super grateful. And let's do more. Thanks, guys. See you guys.